On a serious note, Mr. Verma, thank you for making time today.
No, thanks for having
your being here adds gravitas and content and context to what we are doing. First of all, why all the prepared question? Let me start by asking, what does well-being, personal well-being mean to you?
I think you answered it very well, Anurag, when you were talking about in the last section of what you're talking about. I think well-being and self-care is just being kind to yourself. That's the principle I follow in life. If you're taking care of yourself, if self-care is at the top of your mind, you're just being kind to yourself. And I think in our day-to-day lives, that's the first thing we forget. We think about everything around us, everyone around us. We think, of course, of our own families as well. But at times, we just forget to take care of ourselves. And I think that's what self-care, preventive care, or wellness, as you're calling it, a very holistic term for all of this, which is just being kind to yourself and hence your health, basically.
Thank you. And, you know, the buzzword in healthcare is the three P's of healthcare: preventive, predictive, and personalized.
Personal, yes.
These are three P's. Arvinder educated me.
Yes.
What are the core principles of well-being that you as a company embrace and on which you built your products?
Yeah, so I'll restrict my answer to South Asia, which is the region we work in, which is basically India, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. And I think the first thing we do, or the first thing, so by the way, we are now a three-year-old company, so we are not a buyer itself is very old in India. Bayer Consumer Health is only a three-year-old company. And I was literally the employee number one in Bayer Consumer Health, and we were set up during COVID. So when we were set up, the things that we tried to identify, and we started with India, was to try and identify how does the culture of this country, how do the traditional practices of this country, how can they impact health and wellness? Yeah, so first thing we had to do was to simply understand it. Even though I've been born and brought up and spent more than 45 years in this country living, the first thing we literally did was to, so we have multiple categories. A gentleman, can you be a little silent? Yeah. So we have multiple categories in a company. Nutrition, for example, is the biggest category. And we said, let's understand what does nutrition mean in this country. Before talking to the consumers, we actually spoke to the doctors, to the healthcare practitioners. One big understanding that I guess all of us still have is that the Indian diet is the best diet, or is amongst the most nutritious diets in the world. That was a starting principle that, look, if Indian diet is the most nutritious diet in the world, and if I'm eating a balanced diet every day, which is an Indian diet, do I even need any nutritional supplement? Yeah. So that was a question we posed to the HCPs, to the doctors in India. And we were quite surprised when we did this extensive survey across over 2,000 doctors in India, where they came up and they said that, look, if you are eating a balanced Indian diet day in and day out, even then you would only get up to 70% of all your micronutrient needs. So Indians, irrespective of whatever food they are eating, they need dietary supplements for sure. So that was the first learnings. And we really started from there. We have a big category in pain management. We have a brand called Saridon, which is a head pain brand. We wanted to understand before starting to, you know, embark on advertising that you were talking about. We said, what is the biggest reason for headache? Why do people get headaches? And again, something you mentioned very correctly over there. And the biggest reason for headache is, not surprisingly, stress. So what causes stress in this country? So we again did a big survey, went to the consumers, this was during COVID, this was all during COVID, so obviously COVID itself had a big role to play in the, COVID itself was one of the big factors for stress. But besides COVID, the biggest stress-giving reason in India was financial stress. And you'd be surprised to know that we did the survey amongst men and women separately. And it was the same for both men and women. And some of the other very surprising findings of that survey, well, not very surprising now,
but lack of hair.
We don't have a representative sample, big enough sample size of that. But for example, very surprising finding, women were more stressed than men in India. Financial stress, financial issues were the biggest reason. Metros were more stressed than the smaller cities. And amongst the metros, guess which metro was the most stressed out in the country?
Don't say Delhi.
Delhi. It was Delhi. So we had a lot of these. So see, the first thing we do when we enter a country, whether it's India, Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, we try and understand the culture and the tradition. And something which are common amongst these three countries, amongst this cluster of countries, are firstly that they all have a very strong traditional medicine practice. So in India, it's going to be Ayurveda. Sri Lanka itself has something which is very similar to Ayurveda. Bangladesh has Unani system of medicine. So that has a very strong role to play. That has had a very strong role to play in the beliefs we have. Yoga, you were again talking about yoga. Yoga and meditation, again, is a common theme across at least Sri Lanka and Bangladesh. Buddhism is very strong in Sri Lanka, so mindfulness and meditation becomes very important for them. So understanding of these kind of cultural nuances becomes the most critical factor when you're trying to figure out what it is as a company that you're going to bring. So you first start by identifying these things, then you try and understand, go a little bit deeper, because you've got to be culturally sensitive and you've got these points to work for you. You can't come and say, look, I'm a science-focused company. I'm going to bombard you with the best products which science has created, and you know, you've got to take it because I'm saying so. That doesn't work. That is poor advertising, you know, if I were to sort of put it that way. So understanding of culture and then trying to see how you can fit your what you have to offer to the consumers would be the way to go. And that's how we worked in these three countries.
Sandeep, thank you for taking us through that thought process. Post-COVID, what are the emerging health and wellness trends that you see that may be small just now but are becoming larger and larger?
Yeah, so I think let me just take one step back and tell you the big difference between pre and post, and it's important for us to understand the pre-COVID scenario. So before Bayer, I used to work for another healthcare brand, and we used to work on health hygiene essentially. So we worked a lot in the villages, etc. In general, in India, pre-COVID, absence of illness is called health. That's a definition. If you ask any layperson, or if you were to ask any layperson in India, okay, what does healthy mean to you? He'd say that I'm not ill, or that my child is not ill. He doesn't have cough, cold, fever. He's healthy. So that's a basic understanding that most Indians had, urban, rural, you know, whichever demographic, pre-COVID. Now, if I can call that silver lining, the silver lining in the COVID cloud that came to India was a huge recognition for this word called immunity. Immunity, and immunity is really the bulwark on which preventive healthcare or self-care is based. So what happened post-COVID was that Indians and most, I guess every other developing country, started understanding the importance of preventive healthcare, which has sort of shaped the entire self-care industry, okay, right now in the entire healthcare industry. So words like immunity entered our household during COVID. Now, you know, the word was not understood by anyone, even in cities.
So it was there in the form of, let's say, a probiotic curd. It was there
correct.
At a very basic level.
Correct, correct. It was there at a very basic level. Absolutely right. But it went down to, so, you know, COVID is like the black swan event of sorts. So that was the first thing, which first big trend which came out, which has persisted till now also, which is preventive healthcare. The importance of ensuring that, that I have the right nutrients in my body, or that I'm doing the right things to ensure that I'm not going to fall ill. Just that thought was the first one. Some of the other big trends, which have also come from the West, are the demand for personalized nutrition, personalized healthcare regime. You were talking about your nutritionist, you were talking about how...
Nutritional therapist. Don't call it nutrition.
Nutritional therapist. Like, so the word nutrition therapist also come in post-COVID.
No, by the way, this came, I met her in 2014, and she used to call herself nutritional therapist then also.
It was very rare, but it's become quite common now. So a lot of people are seeking and demanding healthcare products which are tailored to their needs. So it isn't
because everyone's, you know, deficiencies are unique.
Absolutely.
Their needs are unique. Their lifestyles are unique. Their food preferences.
The food preferences.
And tastes,
yes,
are unique.
Yes.
So, you know, it needs to be tailored.
Exactly. Vegetarianism, you were talking about being, yes, turning vegetarian.
For example, I met this company 2-3 years back, and they told me how Indians are low on a certain thing, you know, and what is the cure. And they started a company which is now doing very well. So, you know, for example, Indians are low in vitamin D.
Yes.
Most Indians, I mean.
Yes.
Because we don't get enough sunlight.
Yes.
Because we sit on desks or inside office, we don't walk enough. We don't, you know.
90% vitamin D deficiency.
Magnesium.
Is, yes.
A lot of Indians, because I read a lot on well-being, and Indians are low in magnesium.
Yes.
And, you know.
B12, vitamin B12.
Yes. And again, there are vegetarian supplements, and there are supplements that are not strictly vegetarian, like fish bones, you know, they go into a certain,
yes,
kind of product.
No, so, absolutely. In fact, because vegetarianism is so strong in India, it's not so strong in Bangladesh, not so strong in Sri Lanka either.
Not at all in Bangladesh.
Yeah.
I have been to Bangladesh.
Even in Sri Lanka, it's not that strong. But in India, so when we were launching a product, when we were coming out with new product, we had to take care of that. We wanted to launch products which were vegetarian. Unless you have a product which solves a particular therapeutic purpose for you, okay, you can't get that from plants. So there would be a lot of supplements which are not vegetarian, which are also good. But we said that, look, the kind of problems we are solving, I think we can get it done by having completely vegetarian product also. So we use that. So a lot of the, and that brings me back to the first point which I was making. On what were the big trends and all. And also, vegetarianism is another trend which is rising a lot more. You're talking about the top trends. So consumers are now seeking more vegetarian products in India than they used to earlier. So naturals as a trend has always been there. Almost for 10 years, naturals has been there. Naturals continues. So in terms of trends, like I said, preventive healthcare has become strong. Personalized healthcare, people want personalized pattern. They are seeking vegetarian options because, and this is not
and
just
that's how you make it inclusive and,
that, exactly,
and being culturally sensitive.
Exactly. And and probably the fourth one, another very interesting one, which is, it's not a specific post-COVID trend that we're seeing, but it had been there earlier also, is that Indians are now seeking made in India products. You know, you and I both remember a time when foreign products or when products which were imported into India used to be considered high quality.
I was young and calcium Sandoz.
Calcium Sandoz, you remember? Yeah.
For all of us.
Yeah. So now,
and, you know, even for my kids, I would get my batchmates who live in the US to get me those gummies from,
yes,
when my kids were really small. They're big now.
Yes. So the trend now is that they are seeking local products. They are seeking made in India product. Again, had a big impact on us. So 100% of bio consumer health products are made in India. We said that we will make our products 100% sourced and made in India. So that has become a very important trend. And if I were to give you a slightly, well, these are all positive trends, slightly negative angle, which is again rooted in the culture of this country. I think Indians, Bangladeshi, Sri Lankan, this whole developing emerging economy area, I think we've all grown up in this culture of scarcity, right? We've all grown up in a very hyper competitive culture. We've all grown up in a culture where hard work, you know, is really, really important.
Hustle
is very important.
I mean, I talk about all this, but I'm the kind of person, if I don't work on a Sunday, I feel guilty.
Exactly.
I'm trying to get over that.
Exactly.
Work half Sundays these days, you know. So I always, my book that is coming out, I've been writing for many years. It's called 8 Days a Week. That's my life.
Exactly. That was.
So I agree with you, but yeah, I'm becoming better.
No, that was my point, and I was actually putting it in a slightly negative angle.
It's a negative thing.
Hard work and hustle is important, very important, but eventually it has an impact on your personal well-being, right? So Indians are the hardest working people in the world. Oh, Indians are also the least productive people in the world. The least number of productive days in your life cycle are those of Indians. Okay, we are the worst amongst the three countries in South Asia, among the four countries in South Asia. And that is simply because we work 8 days a week, like you said. It's simply because we believe we should work 72 hours in a week. Okay, you work with your colleagues across the globe.
Mine is a little normal, don't make.
No,
I mean, my work is very
I'm not
different.
Pointing you out. I'm just saying,
but yes,
but it's there. See, it eventually everything has a price. You have to pay a
you
price.
You got to sleep. I mean, I don't send mails in night to anyone. I don't call anyone on Sunday after Saturday 4 p.m. Saturday morning we have reviews. I don't bother anyone. I don't expect anyone to work. But I have a different life, so you know, it's like...
No, but we would also be the most willing to accept those emails. Okay, if you work with somebody in Europe... Or
no, but 10 years back when I was younger, I used to send mails. I used to be up in the night. I used to send mails in the night. I don't do that. Because if I send a mail, somebody may read it. So I don't send it rarely after 6, 7 p.m.
So this is the kind of practice that we should follow more of. But we don't do that. And hence, we end up burning ourselves out a lot faster. Then that was the point which I was going to make. That because of this, the hustle culture is good. But you need to understand that there will be a price to pay. So either you take care of yourself a lot more. You get into this whole exercise, fitness, right diet,
slow down,
right
sleep.
Nutrition, sleep. I mean, you said.
Do things that rejuvenate you.
8 hours, absolutely. I think sleep is the, you already said that, sleep is the best medication for stress. If you can get 8 hours of sleep, nothing like that. So take care of yourself. And that is why I said right at the beginning, you know, taking care of yourself is just being kind to yourself. It will only help you in the long run because you'll just be at your productive best for a lot longer.
Now, also India is a very varied consumer base. Forget Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. If you just take India, how are you able to kind of strategize unique things to be able to cater to that region or a segment, because India has many markets.
No, 100%. So in Bayer, we don't think of India as a country. We think of India as a continent. So we basically, we have the strategy which we call winning in many Indias. It is really not a country. You know, it's easier to do Sri Lanka and Bangladesh than it is in India. So we basically divided India on the basis of language, culture, food preferences. And then we devise the strategies cluster by cluster. It's not all 29 states are not very different, but we've divided them into clusters. So for example, a big chunk of the state, the Hindi-speaking markets or the HSM markets, as we call them, they have a certain culture. And then you have the coastal parts of the country, which have a different diet, a lot more non-vegetarian, a lot more fish. And as the deficiencies there are a little different, the kind of messaging you have to do is a lot more different. The education, the health education or the health literacy levels are a little lower. Are a little lower in the HSM markets, and especially if you go into the rural markets in the HSM belt, you're talking about Bihar, you're talking about rural UP, you're talking about rural MP. So we've done this kind of clustering to identify the right segment. So we do not treat India as a single country. We believe it's a continent of multiple
and
clusters.
How are you able to personalize or be able to do a different strategy for a different reason?
Yeah, so that's the beauty of media. That's why, and see, this is the kind of advertising which works. If your advertising has a same size fits all approach, if your communication to the consumer has that kind of a ring, it'll never work. Okay, but because of the digital revolution, because of the digital platforms available to you, you can now tailor make your messaging to every single city within the same state also, in a language that consumer can understand. So digital has come in a big way. Digital technology has helped us a lot in the sense that you can segment your clusters much better, and you can tailor make your messaging much better than what you could do earlier. So this is only possible now with this whole technology coming in. So we use a lot more tech. We are a very small company also with very few people as such, and hence we use digital, we use AI a lot. We use AI to automate a lot of the stuff that we do. We use AI to augment a lot of stuff that we do as well. So that helps us in, you know, segmenting and clustering this country better, and in tailor making our messages to the cluster.
My last question before I bring in the audience. India has very strong rooted beliefs.
Yes.
Which can also be an hindrance in accepting a new idea, a new discovery. For example, I must tell you, both my parents are about 84 years old or young, whichever way you want to look at. And 10 years back when I first met Rachna, and she said, you have to stop eating wheat.
Stop eating wheat?
Wheat. And you know, I said, how will I survive if I don't eat chapatis? I'm like, I don't feel like eating anything. And she explained to me about gluten. And you know, I had gluten sundaes. I'd look forward to those gluten sundaes where I ate bread pakoras, right? It can't be more gluten than what goes into a bread pakora, right? And he explained to me, and I tried to tell my parents. Then I researched, and you know, the Americans wanted to dump wheat on India. They gave us cheap wheat. Yeah. Wheat sticks to your gut and it harms. And like, both my mom and dad told me basically, shut up, you don't know enough. You think you know more than us. We are more healthy than you, okay? You just shut up. Okay, so after that, I stopped telling them, right? So I'm just giving you my parents very personal, like.
Yeah. Story of all of us.
I go to my parents every Sunday morning, spend 3-4 hours with them, and they'll try to give me, I'm dumbing down on sweets. They said, even ek khale yaar, koi farak nahi padta. I said, I'm not allowed to eat. Nahi, koi farak nahi padta. So, you know, again, and then my mom gives me a certain lecture on food, so how do you deal through your communication, through showcasing content of people who took a certain route and were able to cure themselves over a long period of time? How do you do that?
See, a lot of it, a lot of the practices are actually correct. A lot of the old practices, and it's a realization that a lot of us are getting now, that a lot of the traditional practices, you know, things like eating at the right time, eating different kinds of foods across the year, eating seasonal foods only. Yeah, exactly. So a lot of that understanding is only coming in now. So, and that's why I said that it has to be a mix of it. So you can't say that all of that was wrong. You can't say all of that was right. See, what modern science has given us is an ability to separate the grain from the chaff, since you made the analogy of wheat. So we can figure out which one of these, okay, will work for us now, and which one of these can be scientifically justified. For example, eating seasonal fruits and vegetables can be scientifically justified. It's the right 100%. Thing to do. And some of them cannot be scientifically justified. So fine, you do not need to, you know, follow them. So first is just trying to figure out which one of them work, which ones work for you and which ones will not work for you. And then asking the right questions. I think a lot of the traditional practices and customs, we've always accepted, right? We've not asked the question. So asking the right questions is the other one. And then providing everybody with the right kind of knowledge for them to be able to make a judgment. The idea is not for the companies to tell the consumer that this is right or this is wrong. The idea for us, for a company like us, is to encourage conversations. We've launched a product on period pain. Period pain is such a taboo topic in India. We're trying to encourage conversation. We're not trying to tell you that this is the right thing, this is the wrong thing. At least have a conversation. At least have a conversation on why getting rid of period pain is important, right? So simulating the right conversation, providing information tools, and then you decide yourself. What we will do as a company is that if you've decided to act on that question, so for example, if you've decided that, look, I think, you know, I need some new nutritional help, and as per my health checkup, iron levels are lower in my body. We will ensure that our products are accessible and affordable to you. So that's what, so we will provide this framework of asking, getting you to ask the right question, giving you the right knowledge to make that judgment, and providing the products for you. So we'll be aiding you instead of forcing you towards in that direction.
So it's education. Yeah, and
collaboration.
Awareness.
Complete, exactly, absolutely. And in a very collaborative approach, because these are very deep set beliefs. Very, like you said, these have come from our parents, our grandparents, very deep set beliefs, and a lot of them are actually correct.
You know, I want to say that, you know, it may sound funny, but in my home, when I was growing up, my mom never made sure that for at least 14 days, the same food was not repeated. Different vegetables, different pulses. I know which day is which pulse, and they all have a nutritional purpose.
Yes.
So it was done, and you know, I was joking with my mom and dad that, you know, now I pay a nutritional therapist to be able to tell me chew 32 times. Because my dad, as a kid, I have a good or bad habit of reading. I don't read. When I eat food, I only eat food now. You saw I didn't have my phone. But I would read as a child, and my dad would take away the magazine or the newspaper or the book and say, eat, don't read, just eat. I do that, I try and do slowly because I eat very fast. So I've slowed it down. I am eating small portions. You know, so those are things my dad said to me, you know. I didn't have to go to a nutritional therapist. So clearly the wisdom of the past is being brought upfront by companies like Bayer.
Absolutely.
And providing solutions. So thank you, Sandeep, for being here and giving us your insight. Please give Mr. Sandeep Verma a big round of applause.
Thank you.